Hello everyone, Andy here again to do another bass guitar review, another no-nonsense review, one of my bass guitars. This one happens to be the Ernie Ball Music Man Stingray Special. It is post-2018 when they did the big redesign on their Stingrays. Just want to mention, I've never owned a Stingray before this, so I don't have any reference to give anyone as far as what the old ones were like. My understanding is they were heavier and a little bulkier in some ways, but Ernie Ball did a full redesign where they literally sort of reshaped the body a little bit, recontoured it, did a whole bunch of stuff, and we're going to talk about it. But this is, I believe this was built in early 2019. I actually called Ernie Ball and asked them. So 2019 Ernie Ball Music Man Stingray Special 4-string bass. It is the double humbucker version, obviously. I'm going to give you some really positives about this bass and some negatives. There's quite a few negatives about it. So here we go. First of all, these basses are advertised as this one happens to be, before I get started, this one happens to be what they called the Firemist silver color. And normally I go with, you know, black basses or the natural color basses or the sunburst colors. I pretty much have always stuck with those, but I wanted something really different. And so this one looked really cool. So Firemist silver, obviously white pickguard, white pickup covers, you know, chrome hardware. They're advertising these basses as ash, you know, ash bodies. This one has all of these Stingray Specials have a roasted maple neck. This one happens to have a roasted maple fingerboard as well, which is really cool. I just love the sort of aged look that these basses have. They have a 18 volt preamp. So back here, you've got the 2 9-volt batteries it takes, and there's your electronics. They have contoured the heel, which I guess was not the case with the older ones. So a lot of companies are going with contoured heels just so you can get up to the higher register. So instead of 6 bolts, it's 5 bolts. Still really solid. As I was saying though, they're advertising these basses as ash bodies. They all have the roasted maple necks, and some of them have an ebony free fretboard or a rosewood fretboard, depending on which model and stuff you get. But here's the thing. Here's a big whopper for me. When I was researching these basses, obviously the advertisements for them from Ernie Ball, as well as on most of the music websites and things, are all advertising the bodies as ash bodies. Well, when I bought this bass, it didn't say ash body. It said select hardwood. If you are somebody who's really concerned with what your bass is made of, what the wood is, and that's really important to you. It is to me. I own a lot of bass guitars, been playing a long time. I start to get into the nitty gritty. The older I get, the more I want to know exactly every detail of it. And it turns out that this is not ash. And because I called Ernie Ball and I gave him the serial number of this bass, and I said, hey, the ad for this said select hardwoods. I just want to know if this is ash or not, because you're advertising these basses as ash bodies. And the guy said, well, that particular time that we were manufacturing that bass, we were having a shortage of ash wood. And he said, the wood that we substitute for ash is poplar. So he said, I cannot definitively tell you what wood your body is, but I'm going to guess it's a poplar. So, you know, in a way, it's a disappointment. The bass sounds great, as I'll get into. So I'm not so concerned with that, but it's just kind of irked me, because they should put what wood it is for each bass. When you're paying, this bass was $2,200. $2,199 is what this bass cost. And they're probably higher than that now. Because this was purchased back in, I believe it was late 2019, early 2020. It was 2020 when I bought it. Anyways, so yeah, you know, just put what the wood is. You know, people want to know that stuff these days, especially when you're spending a lot of money on an instrument. You want to know all the details. So poplar, okay. It does sound good, so I'm not so disappointed. That wasn't necessarily a deal breaker for me, but I didn't know that until I bought it. And so that's something to just watch out for. If you're concerned about all the details, make sure you get it. You can call the company like Musician's Friend or Sweetwater and just, you know, make them tell you if they can, if they can find out. Or you could call the company itself, the manufacturer, and see if with a serial number they can give you the stuff. So anyhow, poplar body, most likely, not ash. The redesign goes, so we have a bridge. I guess the bridges before on the old ones were a lot beefier, which did add a lot of weight to the base. These are a very simple, basically bent piece of aluminum. It's, you know, pretty old school, kind of like what you might find on an old, you know, Fender P bass or something, just very basic. They did this so that to reduce weight, and it's fine, but you know, I'm a fan, as I've mentioned in other videos, I'm a fan of the bigger, beefier bridges, you know, solid, like solid brass, for example. I think it does add a little bit more low-end punch, which is what I like. So I think this contributes to sort of a higher-end punch, you know, with this bridge, but that's just my opinion. The electronics in these basses are absolutely amazing. I mean, this is one of the greatest things about the Ernie Ball Music Man Stingray Specials, in my opinion. 18-volt preamp, as you've seen. This one's the double humbucker. And you have a volume, you have a high boost cut, you have a mid boost cut, a low boost cut, and then you have a 5-position toggle switch on the double humbucker. And if it's a single humbucker, it's a 3-position toggle switch. If you go all the way forward, you have just the neck pickup full on. If you go to the next selection, you have these two coils, so the inner coils. If you go to the middle, both are full on. If you go to the next one, it's the two outer coils. And I actually might have that opposite. It might be this second position might be the two outer coils, and then this second to last position might be the two inner coils, but anyways, and then if you go all the way back, it's just this pickup full on. So quite a difference in sound. I mean, you can get almost a P bass sound if you use just this one and, you know, crank up your lows and cut your highs. You can get kind of a P bass sound. I prefer it, the second one from the last, which I believe, like I said, is these two outer coils. It just sounds better. That's just my opinion. The great thing about this electronic setup on these Ernie Ball basses that they're very useful. You can crank all these up and it doesn't distort your system. It doesn't start to sound like crap. Some of the older active basses, if you crank the EQs on the bass itself, it's too much. It's, you know, it's just way too much. But they have designed this so that, you know, it's very useful. You can crank all these up and it just basically boosts your volume, and then you can just cut and boost whatever you want and really change the sound, and it's very, very useful. It sounds great. Nothing's too much on these electronics. So they really did a nice job of designing these. The other thing you may not hear mentioned is that this is what I call a true volume. If on a lot of basses, especially the passive basses, as soon as you start to roll off volume, you lose tone. Yeah, a lot of your like mids just drop out, highs drop out, and the tone just suffers. They have designed this so that when you lower the volume on the bass, it's literally just lowering the volume. It is not messing with the tone at all, and that is proven. So if you go just a barely on, it sounds just like it's supposed to. You know, if you go full on, it sounds like it's supposed to. It doesn't mess with the tone, and that's a big criticism I have of a lot of basses, is if you start messing with the volume on your bass, your tone suffers. And I hate that. Because in a live situation, when you're, you know, playing in a band, you need to cut a little volume or need to add a little volume, you can do that right here on the bass without touching your amp. Very convenient. So I absolutely I love this. Single volume, you know, active basses. I just love that feature. So kudos to Ernie Ball for doing that. So there's that. I love the little truss rod wheel right here. They do give you a tool. They give you a tool to adjust the saddles as well. They also give you what's the other tool? I think just those two. So they give you an Allen key for these, and then they give you the tool to adjust the truss rod right here. Super convenient, super easy. To me, that's a given nowadays. You should be able to do that. So then, as I said, We've got the roasted maple neck and roasted maple fingerboard. I just love the way this thing feels and looks. I'm just totally sold on roasted maple. I don't know if you guys have experience with roasted maple necks. They're just so silky smooth. There's just no sticking points, you know, that you get with a high gloss finish if you're sweating. So really, really nice. This has just got the black block or black dot markers. And another feature on these Stingray Specials is these are stainless steel fret wire versus nickel fret wire. And that's supposed to be to last longer. That's what I've been hearing, is that it lasts longer. Obviously, time will tell. I'm sure it does. You have a compensated nut. So a compensated nut, this is the only base I've owned that has a compensated nut, and I had to research what that meant. But my understanding basically is that where the string sits in the saddle is in a slightly different spot for each string to allow for more perfect intonation. That's my understanding. If I'm wrong about that and somebody knows out there, please correct me. But my understanding of a compensated nut is that the position is slightly different where the string actually sits on the saddle, you know, forward or back to allow for tighter harmonics. And this bass does have great harmonics. It's very, very harmonically rich, very precise harmonics. So kudos for that. They redesigned the tuning keys on this bass. They're lighter. I guess they took almost a pound off the weight of the bass with just redesigning the tuning keys. I was skeptical because, once again, I like beefier hardware. It's tougher, but these are actually really nice. They're very smooth. They're tight. They don't budge. They're not hard to adjust. And, so I think they're great. So with that, I'm going to just give you my general criticism. It's great that they redesigned these basses. I love how, you know, this bass is very well balanced when you have it on. You don't have neck dive. It's just really nice. That's so important nowadays, especially if you're doing 3 and 4 hour gigs a lot. I mean, it's talk about strain on the shoulder. I don't know if you guys have experience with that, but it can really get tiresome. So having a well-balanced instrument is really nice, and this bass is very well-balanced, as you can see. No neck dive at all, so very good on that. But here's the thing. Companies nowadays are, in general, this goes across the board with really every big company out there. They're doing everything they can to cut costs. And they're trying to figure out how can we market and either keep the price the same or even raise the price while we cut costs to increase profit. I have no problem with businesses making a good profit and cutting costs and stuff. It's just good business to do that. But sometimes I was pretty critical of Ernie Ball on this because I think they just went real cheap on the bridge. And I would have rather had a better, you know, higher quality, maybe beefier bridge, as I mentioned. Once again, the tone wood, why didn't they mention exactly what it was? Hey, if it's poplar, say it's poplar. But it's almost like they don't want to tell you because they don't want you to think, well, I want ash, so I'm not going to buy it. That's just my opinion. A compensated nut, I don't really think it's necessary on a bass guitar. That's my opinion. And if you guys have a different opinion, I'd love to hear it in the comments. I don't think it's necessary, and if it adds to the cost of the bass, it just, to me, it's pointless because, you know, I have every other bass I have, most of them have really great harmonics as well, and intonation and everything, and, you know, with a bass guitar, it's low enough frequency that I just don't see the need. That's my opinion. So, yeah, that's basically it for this bass, but I just want to give you the whopper, and that is that when I bought this bass, the first thing I do anytime I buy a bass guitar is I straighten the neck, make sure the neck is straight. I'm very OCD about that. Straight neck. And then I adjust the action to conform to basically what I have my other basses at. And I have a string height gauge, string action gauge that I use to try to get the action just where I want it. But with this bass, right off the bat, even when I had the action slightly higher than some of my other basses, I would have open string fret buzz. And that's very annoying. And then I'd have really bad fret buzz starting at the 7th fret on the E string and up. And I so, you know, I've adjusted the neck multiple times to try to figure out what, you know, what is going on here. I have a straight edge I use to make sure the neck is straight. And the neck's straight, everything, the action's just where it is on my other bases, and yet I'm getting this horrible fret buzz on the E string and open string E string fret buzz, which you can hear right there. So that was a problem for me because none of my other bases have that problem. I adjusted it just the same as the other bases. They don't have that problem. This one does. So what's the issue? Is it a fret issue? Is it, you know, the height of the where the string sits in the groove here? I don't know. I mean, I played for 25 years, owned tons of bases, but that it just was a mystery to me. So I called Ernie Ball and was still under warranty. And I said, hey, you know, I'm getting some fret buzz issues that I can't resolve. I've been playing a long time. It's not like I'm a new player and I don't know what's going on. And they said, okay, well, send it back to us. So I sent this bass back to Ernie Ball, and it took about a month, and they sent it back and they said, yeah, we had to do a fret dress. We had to level the frets. Now that's great. They took care of me. They didn't charge me and they leveled the frets, and it is better now. But once again, it's kind of like I paid $2,200 for this bass. This is a brand new redesign, Ernie Ball, you know, something really special. You know, it's a Stingray special. And yet I had that problem. And it really makes me wonder about the quality control and what these companies are doing. They're just, you know, shaving costs, laying people off, you know, and I just don't know if the quality control on a lot of stuff, even higher end stuff, is what it should be. So even though they did take care of me, and I appreciate that, I just wonder why that had to happen at all. So anyhow, but all in all, this bass has an amazing sound. The poplar body does not bother me. I can almost get a Rickenbacker sound with this bass when I have this this setting with the two outer coils, you know, and it has a really high-end punch sound to it. Very unique, very different than anything I've ever owned. So yeah, I put the stickers on it. I know some people don't like that, but decided to get crazy. So anyhow, Ernie Ball, Music Man Stingray Special Firemist Silver, double humbucker, beautiful instrument. I will cut into some showing you the case. The cases are very nice, and the case candy they give you is very nice. So stay tuned.